I'd like to get started because we have a lot of things to discuss. This week, I want to go over as much as possible the Maxwell equations and electromagnetic waves. They are, of course, very important in our lives. At this moment, electromagnetic waves are passing through your body, passing through the air. We don't pick up the radio waves because we don't have the right antennas. We're picking up the light waves in our eyes, so we know about them. But if you brought a radio in here, you would, in principle, pick up the radio waves that are coming through. The cell phones that you might take out of your pocket would pick up the cell phone, microwave radiations, just a whole spectrum of electromagnetic radiations going on all the time if you walk around in a civilized place. And even, well, obviously, there's light even in uncivilized places, you know, part of the time at least. So, well, those are all electromagnetic radiations, it turns out. And that idea was first understood by this brilliant man, James Clerk Maxwell. He wrote his theories down around the year 1860. What he did was he read very carefully the notebooks of Faraday. He wanted to understand the experiments very well. And then Faraday, as I mentioned to you, was not mathematically educated. He really never went to school much until he was about age 14. So he pretty much self-taught and just had a feeling for things. And he would describe things in terms of his feels, but he couldn't express them mathematically. It was Maxwell, who was an extraordinary genius, who was able to collect Faraday's ideas, the ideas of the French school, Biot and Savart, and Ampere, and then add, the one thing that he did add was this idea that if you had a time-varying electric field, that it would act as though it were a current. That is not obvious to the outsiders, but Maxwell got that idea from there. As I said, I don't know exactly how he came up with it, but it's subject to experiment. You postulate something like that for one reason or another, good or bad. By the way, a lot of good ideas come from the wrong reasoning. If you want, I'll give you some good examples of that. In other words, sort of luck. And there are a lot of good ideas that prove to be wrong. So you don't really know until you try. And fortunately, nature will give you an answer by and by. But this was a good idea, and it was right. And it's profoundly important because what it means, as we'll see, is that when you ask what are the equations for the sources of the electromagnetic field, you have to add this current into the equation we wrote before for the magnetic field. We had Ampere's law, which Maxwell knew very well. And that is to say that if you have a wire with carrying a current, that if you make a loop around the wire, let me put the current going into the blackboard, say, we use our right-hand rule number one, put our thumb in the direction of the current, and you'll get loops of magnetic lines going around that current. And if you multiply the B times the little steps as you move around the whole loop, it'll tell you how much net current is enclosed by your loop. Well, okay, so now Maxwell says, let's take the assumption that there is an additional current, not a physical charge moving, but even an empty space. The space itself displaces and produces kind of a polarization or displacement of the charges in the space, some vague idea like that yet. And so let's add to this current this time-varying thing, epsilon naught V phi electric, ET. So it's just added on to your real physical current of electrons moving in a wire. And that made all the difference, because what it means is that you can go to places where there is no free current, let's say empty space between here and the sun, and you can create a magnetic field simply by changing the electric field in that space. You get a magnetic field. And then you could use, let me move over to the Maxwell equations. This is the idea of one justification for that displacement current. The ultimate justification is we try it and see what it predicts, and if it predicts the right thing, we accept it. That's what nature has given us. So here it is, where you have your loop of field around a current, you have your regular current, U0i, in addition, U0 multiplies this epsilon naught E phi electric. And this completes a set of equations for the sources of electric and magnetic fields. In other words, electric fields are created by electric charges, that was the very first lecture in the course, static electric charges, and they are subject to Gauss's law, Coulomb's law, and also changing magnetic fields, which is the equation of Faraday, that you get an electric field around the loop as minus E phi magnetic decay. So that's another source of an electric field due to changing magnetic fields. We see that's a very profound thing because we were able to change the magnetic field in a loop and get an electric current around the loop, pull out that current, and now finally they're able to power Dwinell Hall from the power lines. I understand from today's Daily Cal, and that's nice. And it all comes from Faraday's law because they're now changing magnetic flux through a loop and they're getting an electric field. So that's Faraday. Then we found that magnetic fields were caused, we said there are no magnetic charges, no isolated norths and souths, but if we do have a current like this, a steady current will produce a magnetic field around it, and that will be one source of the current. That's Ampere's law plus we have to add in now Maxwell's displacement. So this will give us the source of the magnetic field. And deep down, it's the same reason that a bar magnet is magnetic. The reason is that every atom, not every atom has electrons, but special atoms have electronic magnetic moments. And so there are, deep down in those materials, circulating currents that are producing a magnetic field in these bar magnets. And those bar magnets have the elementary magnets are so well coupled that they form strong, aligned ferromagnet. In some cases, not every material has that. But as I say, we do have some with iron in that whole list I showed you. Okay, so here we have, on this list, and I'll show them again a bit more graphic mathematically, we have the four equations, one for static charges first, that's Gauss's law if you want, it's the same as Coulomb's law, but a little more general. Then for the magnets, we have that the Gauss's law for magnetism says there are no monopoles, as yet found. And Faraday's law, which will help generate electric field, again, sort of like the first equation, this is another way of generating electric field, changing magnetic flux. And then again, we have the fourth one, the Ampere-Maxwell law, that can generate these by current, that's the term on the right, real electrons moving a wire, or could be a particle, charged particle moving. But in addition, just changing electric fields will do it, which is incredible. Well, it's credible now because we know it's proved to work. So here they are in empty space, where in fact we have now taken away all charges and currents. So you see on the right side, or the lower right-hand side, I've taken out the I, and that means that there's really no charges or currents in the space, but nevertheless, we have equations which says that you can generate an E by changing B, and you can get a B by changing E in time, okay? Okay, now what Maxwell then did, and here's where you have to be a mathematician, a very good mathematician indeed, he was able to show that because of these changing things in space and time, you could write that the electromagnetic fields had the form of what's called a wave equation. And I'm not going to bother you with deriving Maxwell's equation. We can. From what you know, you can do it. I gave you some slides at the end of this PowerPoint presentation. There are some slides which, if you want to see how you can justify this. But the basic idea is, look, you have a wave. A wave varies in space, and a wave varies in time. Think of a water wave. It comes in, it hits you, proceeds to the beach. So it's varying in time, and it's varying in space. So an equation that describes that should have something which is varying in space, which is the left side of the equation. See that derivative? That fancy curlicue thing is just a way of saying, if I have some wave, it's a function of x distance and time. But if I want to take a derivative of it, for example, I have sine something, let me put it kx minus omega t. Now suppose I want to take the derivative of that, what do I mean? Well, there are two things that can be varying, it's varying in space and varying in time. But if I want to just take the derivative with respect to space, I take the derivative of sine as cosine, and I just take the derivative of the x part. So I get cosine kx, and the k comes out in front. Well, no, the derivative of, let me do a little better. Suppose I take the derivative of this, but only with respect to x, just for fun. So you take the derivative of sine as cosine, and then you get kx, but the k comes out in front. So you get something like that. So you haven't taken the derivative with respect to t, because it told me just take the derivative with respect to x. So that's what this mathematical procedure is. If I want to take the derivative with respect to t, I would just take the same thing, and it would come out minus omega cosine of omega t. Well, actually, to be fair, I think it'd probably be kx minus omega t cosine kx minus omega t, with an omega coming out in front, because I've only taken the derivative with respect to t. So that's what that means. And it turns out that all waves pretty much come into that kind of form. We have derivatives with respect to time and derivatives with respect to space. And sine wave is a very good solution of that kind of equation. Ah, but then you have to, and we will, understand what all those parts mean. You see there's a... Yeah, I'll explain more detail. Now, we are talking here about a particular kind of wave, electromagnetic waves, but I want you let me go back here. I don't want you to just learn about electromagnetic waves. I want you to have a feeling for all waves, because in the course of your life and experience and work even, you will encounter a lot of different waves. And to say, I don't know anything about this wave because it's an ultrasonic wave, and I may just talk about electromagnetic waves. No, there are general properties of waves, and it's more important than any particular case. I want you to learn general properties of waves. And what they typically have is a speed, how fast the wave moves, water waves, light waves, sound waves, waves on this table, magnetic waves propagate down, because if you go down there, you'll feel it. They have a frequency, they have a wavelength, they have an amplitude. We'll go into all these. And there's another effect that is interesting, that the frequency that you hear a wave, that a wave may have, will depend on how fast you're moving with respect to the source of the wave. This is something you probably experienced called the Doppler effect. Anybody not heard of the Doppler effect? Oh, they don't explain it, good. And waves typically have a polarization, meaning they will oscillate in some direction or other. Sound waves, you probably already had an 8A, I hope you remember that sound waves don't oscillate this way because they have no strength in this direction. You can't see a thing like this. It has some strength in the sideways direction, so I can make a wave sideways, but air has no strength in the sideways direction. All you can do is compress it. So it polarizes the longitudinal wave, sound is. So different waves have different kinds of polarization, but they all have some kind of polarization, namely some direction in which the particle or the stuff, whatever it is that's oscillating or waving, moves. They carry energy. Anybody who's been hit by a strong wave will know that. Or the sunlight brings its energy. They actually have momentum. They can actually exert a force on a surface. The extreme example that I'll bring up is the hydrogen bomb, which is created by the pressure of light. The light of an atomic bomb creates a hydrogen bomb. That's the pressure there. It's not a secret. it's well known how that works. Now it's known. It was a secret when it was first made. So they exert pressure. They also reflect, like waves reflect. You're seeing me because of the reflected light. The light started there, and pretty much all we see is pretty much by reflected light, you come to think of it. Except for the sun. You look at the sun, it's a source of light, but these lamps. But everything else is reflected, right? You think about it. And there are different kinds of reflection. There's like the reflection you see in a mirror, which is perfect, perfect reflection. I don't know if you've had the experience, if your bathroom mirror fogs over, suddenly you don't see yourself anymore. You see the mirror, in a way, the fog, you see. So you don't see yourself. We'll get into that when we talk about optics. That's going to be in a week or so. But that's a very important idea. There are different kinds of reflections. Waves also diffract, meaning they go around corners. They don't cast perfect shadows. Very important property. They can also interfere with each other. You can have the plus part of a wave with the minus part of a wave. If they superimpose, they can cancel out, which is something particles can't, really, well, most particles can't. If I have one weight and I have one mass and another mass, they usually don't annihilate. I have two masses. But waves have the property, yes, sir. What if you have a mass moving at the speed of light? Well, you won't get a mass moving at the speed of light, for starters. But even then, it doesn't change anything. The only way masses annihilate is if they have plus and minus charges. That can happen. A plus charge, let's say plus electron and a minus electron, they can combine, and you'll get no mass anymore. The mass will be carried off by the radiation. You don't really lose mass, but it's carried off by radiation, so you won't have particle anymore. But you're anticipating special relativity, friend, and you have to wait till Wednesday to get the answer to that. But that's a good point. Things going at the speed of light changes things quite a bit, but it doesn't change the idea that if you have two masses and you put them on each other, you usually don't annihilate them. Whereas waves, they annihilate on a regular basis. In places, they can, with the pluses and the minuses, the crests and the troughs combined. And then you can get these what's called rogue waves. Ever heard of that idea? Where you get ocean waves which combine and they build up, and then all of a sudden you get this giant wave and some ship gets toppled. Have you heard of that idea? That's an interference effect where the two waves add up. And I dare say you could get a rogue trough, where two troughs combine, and you get deep. things. But that's what waves do, because there's plus and minus parts of a wave, right? Okay, so those are the general properties. Every wave does these things, and I'd like you to know that, more than knowing the specifics of the electromagnetic wave. What we'll bring out, the other very important thing is you can get standing waves, where you can get, for example, a violin string or a musical instrument that has a certain size, and the wave will bounce back and forth between the ends of the thing, and you can build up a large amplitude of standing wave. And that, because, for example, if you had a violin and you just had a string, you could have a tense string and just draw the bow over the violin, you could barely hear it. But if you put it over a case, so the sound can get in and can vibrate the case kind of builds it up, and then you can project, you know, fill a concert hall. It's, that's a standing wave. If you build up a standing, the wave goes in, it bounces around and builds up. And it's kind of a resonance, too, because of the shape of the violin. So those standing waves are very important, and that's what goes on in atoms, really. That's the reason we have energy levels in atoms, is because there are standing waves of electrons in an atom. I don't know if you're familiar with that idea, but we're going to get into that in quantum theory. But that's why I bring it up, because it's really very important. Especially, you know, I'll give you a preview of this. You know, you've heard of Schrodinger's equation for atoms and so on. Schrodinger, in his first paper, said, I'm going to be telling you about standing waves in an atom, like standing waves in a violin string, like on a violin string. That's how he introduced his paper. People don't talk about that much, but that's what he actually said. I'll have to get a copy of that and show it to you. It's very insightful. Okay, so now we have to define what we mean by properties of a wave. Here's a typical sine wave. And what it says is that if you look in the space direction, that it has, if you take a snapshot of it, it will have peaks and troughs. Now, the distance between like points on the wave is called the wavelength. You surely have seen this before. A wavelength between like points, say, crest to crest, or trough to trough, or middle to middle, that's the same length. We call that the wavelength. And sometimes it's more convenient to use the symbol K, called the wave number, because it comes in, that's what I wrote here. See, that's 2 pi over the wavelength. I'm not going to pass you too much with that at this moment, but that's the general idea. Now, on the other hand, waves vary in time. If you stand at one place, you'll see the wave go by, and it'll go by like this, right? So if you stand at one place and just count in time, you'll get a time dependence that will look like that. And we count the time between like points. That time is called the period of the wave. And the inverse of the period is the frequency. And we sometimes also use angular frequency, omega, which is how many 2 pi's the thing does per second. How many 2 pi's angle does it trace out? So that's general description of most waves. Not every wave is a sine wave. I think water waves don't look, especially the big ones, you know, where they come in, the giant, the maverick type wave. It looks like this, and the guy goes under the thing. That doesn't look quite like a sine wave, but you'd actually express it. Although, you know, the maverick looks very strange. Have you ever seen those with the crescent like this? Now, that has 2 values in a way. It's kind of a funny thing, because it's sort of like curling. You have a hard time describing that mathematically, actually. It's even worse trying to write it, I'm sure. Not the same people doing both, I think, writing in mathematics of it. But anyhow, the results for the electromagnetic wave, it looks something like this. These I'm going to tell you without proof, because that means going through all the math and everything. But what it is, first of all, is that there's a constant ratio between, I don't know if you can see that. E is going up, and here B is going up also. Can you sort of see that? So that they are in constant ratio. The ratio of E to B is actually turns out to be the speed of light. And what's happening is that E is changing with time and space, and B is changing with time and space. And so we use the time-dependent parts. The time-dependent change of E is producing a B, and the time-dependent part of B is creating an E, sort of in proportion to itself. And so the wave goes along bootstrapping itself. That's how we think of it. And the thing that you want to know is that the direction, first of all, they are at right angles to each other, the way it's shown here, and the direction is in the direction of the, again, it's right-hand cross product E into B, so that if you put your fingers in the direction of E and turn it in the direction of the B, that will be the direction in which this wave would propagate, namely this way. Not this way, this way. And you see that it's passing by. If you're at one place, you'll see the peaks getting higher and lower, and in time, oscillating up and down, and that will give you the frequency. Or you take the snapshot like this, you'll see that the wave is going from here to here. This is the wavelength. Now, the amplitude, some people sometimes confuse the amplitude with the wavelength, because they both seem like lengths, but they're very different. One is a distance in space. The other is a thing that's waving. It could be water, the height of water, right? It's not, but it's water, it's not length. In this case, it's an electric field. And what other kind of waves do we have? We have sound waves, where the thing here is pressure that's varying with distance. So the amplitude is just the size of the stuff that's varying. So don't get confused with wavelength. Although we draw pictures like that, it looks like that's a length and looks like that's a length, but that's not correct, that you see, right? So that's a very common mistake. Let's see, where are we? So we have these EM waves, and they have these properties which you can deduce from the mechanism, namely the fact that the changing B in time induces E, Faraday, and changing E induces B by Mr. Maxwell. So they generate each other, and when you go through, as Mr. Maxwell did, and generate these equations for this, what you get, when you roll through, now I'm not going to torture you with this, but you can see that you get equations for E and B, where you get the second derivative with respect to space, sort of like, and a second derivative with respect to time, way over here, with this coefficient, epsilon naught and mu zero, in front. So it is a wave equation.